We are going to start with the presentation of Dario Del Pupo. He is a professor and chair of the Department of Language and Culture Studies at Trinity College. He is also chair of the Barbieri Endowment for Italian Culture. He has published on manuscript and book history, Petrarca, Leopardi, and on food history and culture. His article on nourishment and nature in Leopardi has just come out in Italica. At Trinity, he teaches courses in food, history, and culture, Italian literature and cinema, as well as on sustainability. And his talk today, the title of his talk is, What Did Early Modern Italy Sound Like?
Thank you very much, Christine, for chairing the panel and also for the introduction. Thank you, Joseph and Anthony, and the entire staff of the Calandra Institute for the opportunity to present at this conference and for this wonderful conference. The morning sessions were fantastic. I've been compelled, not only by the field, but by just things I've been listening to and listening to manuscripts and texts for perhaps a little too long that I hear them talk. What did early modern Italy sound like? First of all, because I know not everyone here may have different views about this, by early modern, we normally mean, for historians, the period that goes from 1492 to the 19th century in some cases, all right? Well, end of the 19th century. However, I'm an Italianist, which means I study Italian language and literature. So for the purposes of today's lecture presentation, I'm going to push that back to about the 13th century. You say, wait a second, what's that about, right? Well, I'll tell you why. Many of the cultural changes that occurred that we associate with the Renaissance were brought about first in the late Middle Ages. Dante, Petrarca, and Boccaccio exert an enormous influence on Italian literature of the Renaissance and of the early modern period, and of the modern period, if you know what I'm talking about. But what did early modern Italy sound like? Well, ask ourselves, what did it look like? Well, we sort of know what it looked like because we've got all these paintings and artworks and monuments and architecture. We've got housewares and weapons. We've got manuscripts and we've got all sorts of documents that can tell us what Italy looked like, all right? And we know to some degree, a great degree, what Italy sounded like, at least in terms of music. Although I dare say the musicologist would probably say, we do know a lot, but we don't know as much as we'd like, which is always the case. But what do we really know about the ambient sounds? What things sounded like? For example, are there sounds from the Middle Ages that have gone extinct and that are preserved maybe in words? And quite to the contrary, flip it around. Are there words that we use that have lost their phonic quality, all right? That is the phonic connotation. And more importantly for us in this audience, and this is something my students, my undergraduate students really want to know more about, is what were things really like? So you have to say, what did they sound like? What did they look like, all right? And one of the problems is that literature and language have been given short shrift as repositories, immense repositories for evidence of this kind. We don't have recordings, but we do have a record. It's a written record, all right? So in this paper, I intend to examine three instances, some well-known, some lesser well-known, that will highlight and illustrate this point. There are a few related questions too, as I said. And those are things that perhaps you'll be interested in helping me to answer. So with that said, I'd like to go into my first example. But first, also another little reflection. As a scholar of manuscript and book history, I'm always interested in how manuscript copies of the same text, different copies, even if the variants are the same, represent differently that text. Because each manuscript is an instantiation, a materialization of a kind of reading. And reading, though, is a dynamic, temporal activity, one that's ephemeral, just as sound and listening are, all right? So that's why, at once, I'm going to make a case for literature being this immense repository, but at the same time, I'm going to prendo con una mano, do con una mano e tiro con l'altro, because as Nicole Boivin, the archaeologist, has reminded us, language-based approaches to the study of material culture is highly problematic, because language is always an intermediary. It's an abstract, right? It's not the thing in itself, except in those words that actually are onomatopoeic or suggest very strongly the material features of the word. So let me begin with my first example. One of the most famous episodes of the Divina Commedia is Dante's and Virgil's encounter with Pierre de la Vigna in the barren wood of the Suicides. Pierre had served as Frederick II's chancellor and advisor. He was wrongly accused of treason and torture. He then committed suicide. The consummate rhetorician and Latinist, Pierre is a link to the classical world for Virgil and Dante. And Dante, as we know, in part identifies with Pierre de la Vigna. Both are wrongly accused. Both are wonderful craftsmen and artists of the word. But there is also a major difference. Dante will endure the tribulations of his exile, whereas Pierre takes his own life and is therefore committed to hell. Pierre de la Vigna's tragic ending is meant to underscore humankind's submission to God. Critics have analyzed Dante's mimetic representation, and Leo Spitzer, the great romance philologist, long ago highlighted the classical literary and rhetorical sources of the episode. The entire seventh circle, the circle of the violent, where we find ourselves, that is the second ring of the seventh circle, is a noisy, cacophonous, and horrifying place, as is most of the Inferno, with very few exceptions, such as Limbo. Let us focus, however, not on the quantity, the sound decibels, but on the quality, the timbre of the sounds. As Dante and Virgil enter, there initially seems to be an eerie silence in this wood without paths, which is analogous to the morally and metaphorically dark wood in which the pilgrim finds himself at the beginning of the poem. The pilgrim hears guai. It's a word he uses often in the Divina Commedia, guai, wailings. Guai is a word of Germanic origin that you can see from the word itself, it's very much associated with wail. But it has lost some of its power in contemporary Italian. When I say sono nei guai, I mean I'm in trouble. Ho un guaio. We don't necessarily think of the phonic, sound imagistic aspect of that word. From the outset, the entire episode of Canto 13 in Inferno hinges on dissonant syntax and sound imagery that emphasize themes of regret, negation, self-destruction, and death. In the verses on the handout that I've given you, Dante's soundscape is a crescendo of harsh and bitter rhymes, an expression that the poet will use later in the Commedia, consisting of velars, sibilants, post-alveolars, shh, sounds, right? All of which mimetically represent the experience of walking in a woods of dead and withered tree stumps, brambles, and leaves. The only thing missing here is the hissing of a forest fire. But the mimesis is only apparently obvious, as I've learned in teaching this canto to students for over 30 years. Why? Because my students don't readily pick up on these things. They hear the sounds, but they don't cognitively process them. And this brings me to the earlier question about, do we hear and listen with medieval and early modern ears, right? From the point of view of the physiology, of course, our hearing hasn't changed all that much, the organ, right, in evolutionary time. But as a neuroscientist and cognitive scientist constantly pointing out to us, that our brain is so plastic and that the neural networks and pathways, the downstream, upstream communication between different parts of the brain that control the senses, actually is shaped by long practice and habituation. So it's quite possible that If it were possible to transpose someone from the Middle Ages and stand them, they would hear sounds, they might not be able to process them in the way that we might. And that's why when we go for a walk in the woods, we don't hear certain things, but we hear others, perhaps. Okay? Critics have long focused on the synesthesia of this particular canto, the integration of the different senses of seeing, touching, and then believing, on the one hand, and the sounds of the wood's detritus and of the disembodied souls expressing their pain and suffering with each puncture wound inflicted by the harpies. Sounds in the canto are loaded with meaning. The wails, we said, the creaking, cigolare, of the trees, and the moaning, the gemere, emanating from the broken branches, are paradoxically anthropomorphizing terms. Dante's barren wood had metaphorical meanings that were real to his contemporaries, as real and meaningful to them as a walk in the woods is to a great degree meaningless and unreal to us today. Although the medieval, magical, realist representation of wilderness, especially of trees, it seems to be making a comeback, as I will explain shortly. To make the wood of the suicides more recognizable to his listeners, Dante references Corneto and Cecina, sort of bookend towns that describe roughly the Maremma region, which was for Dante and in his time a kind of wilderness, an uninhabited wilderness, marshland, and also, you know, but it's the complete opposite, interestingly enough, from the landscape he wishes to evoke. It's a strategy he uses in different places of the comedy to evoke a very vivid landscape, but one that is, in a sense, diametrically the opposite. Because the Maremma is teeming with wildlife, with myriad flora and fauna. And so it is in some ways the opposite. I'm going to make, for the sake of hyperbole, that is, for just making this point, I'm going to say that the Maremma and some parts, some forests of the upper Apennine were probably, to Dante and to many people in his time, what, you know, the 19th century jungle would have been maybe to some explorers, Western explorers, or perhaps even the tropical rainforest to 16th century conquistadores in Brazil, right? So, but it's interesting that he chooses that image, right? Because it has a meaningful biophony and geophony, right? The Italian countryside in early modern Italy was being rapidly domesticated and reclaimed. And therefore, it was becoming progressively more anthropophonic. Now, my colleague, Sean Cocco, reminded me the other day that that's true, but there's also great momenti of riflusso. For example, in the aftermath of the Black Plague of 1348, a lot of farmland went fallow, and so it rewilded. And there were places in Italy that periodically that occurred because of drought, famine, disease, and so forth. For Dante's listeners, the Maremma was the epitome of a no man's land and a source of dread and terror in an age in which fantastic and visionary tales and medieval bestiaries were still influential genres. The woods and forests were at once fictional and real and spoke of hidden truths within them, not unlike what Dante intended for his extended allegory. Dante's contemporaries did not harbor ecological or environmentalist sentiments for the landscape in the way that we do today. But the material objective reality also held a spiritual and otherworldly dimension. Sound imagery of the dystopic landscape of Inferno 13, moreover, might have even conditioned Dante's audience's perception and experiences of wild places, such as the Maremma. Just as film, television, and other representations of places in our own world condition our response to them before we've even traveled them and made our personal acquaintance. Interestingly enough, we might be on the verge of repopulating the woods and forests with visionary tales, nymphs, and other beings, along with them with allegories of hidden truths. Popular culture and media has long made hay with the medieval cultural imagination. But it is science that is confirming many of the so-called superstitious interpretations of nature that we attribute to pre-modern societies. Peter Wallenben's nonfiction book about the hidden life of trees is based on such rigorous science. Wallenben discusses how trees and more generally the community of trees in a forest or wood interact. Trees communicate with one another. They come to each other's aid. They have feelings, so to speak. For Dante, the wood is principally an allegory of his own spiritual frailty, and that of the suicides represents death and destruction. But the allegory only makes sense if the forest and trees already allude to other meanings for the poetic's audience. In this regard, sound plays a crucial role in the representation and interpretation of natural and unnatural phenomena. And I'm going to give you one more example. This is the Sacchetti's novella, and it's one of the most entertaining stories of the Middle Ages to my mind. In this novella by Franco Sacchetti, who lived he lived in the second part of the 14th century, is a story that features Dante as a character. And it runs something like this. Dante is out on a mission one day, on an errand. He's going to the Palazzo Vecchio to testify in support of a family friend who's been accused of some wrongdoing and is being heavily fined. And on his way to the court, to the Palazzo Vecchio in any case, he passes by a blacksmith's forge. And there, what does he do? He does a double take because he hears a blacksmith pounding away at his anvil and reciting his Il Libro, which we assume to be the Commedia. Dante stops, as I said, does a double take, bursts into the shop, trashes it, takes all the blacksmith's tools and throws them out in the street, right? And of course, the blacksmith is completely shocked, right? He's completely shocked, and Dante and protests vehemently, and Dante tells him off, and saying, "Tu canti il libro e non lo di, come io lo feci. Io non ho altra arte e tu me la guasti." Il fabbro, gonfiato, non sapendo rispondere, raccoglie le cose e torna al suo lavoro. E se volle cantare, cantò di Tristano e di Lancelotto e lasciò stare il Dante. That is, "I will do with the tools of your art that which you have done with mine." So, Dante instructs us, most certainly, and the blacksmith, a right and wrong way about how to recite his book. That is the Commedia, which, by the way, is a complete anachronism. And he's also, in a sense, asserting his own intellectual property rights. Right? And for us today, literary critics, it's, of course, a wonderful example of the inevitability and of the instability of texts. For our purposes here today, and I conclude, the blacksmith's clumsy recitation occurs because he is likely using a regular rhythmic beat that is characteristic of the simpler meter of the popular cantari, and not of the more nuanced Hendika syllable that Dante adopts with its rich and varied internal metrical dynamics. Dante's may be a popular poem, but it is not as rhythmically simple and regular as the blacksmith's hammering on his anvil would require. Dante's eruption is one of the earliest instances, if not the first such instance, of the sound criticism of literature. And I will leave the last story, which is from the Novellino. I've given you the Italian version and the English version to read on your own. And you can tell me how sound plays an important role in that story. Thank you.
I love the Sacchetti novella. It's so funny. And I'm wondering, because you mentioned the question of the libro is anachronistic in this context. And I'm wondering also, there's a debate about this Sacchetti novella, and I was wondering to get your take on it, about whether or not he's just using this for humorous effect, or can we say that there's some kind of historical basis for the oral recitation of something like the Commedia?
The comedy was read later in the century after Dante's death that Boccaccio organized public readings. It's, you know, I mean, I don't know exactly, I can't answer your question directly. It is a fictional account. It's entirely fictional, and I wouldn't use it necessarily as a historical source to describe philologically the spread of Dante's text. But it is molto divertente because Sacchetti is raising an interesting problem, just as Dante's commentators from mid-century had raised the problems where they comment and they say, Dante means this. Well, but there are different comments and different commentators. So not everyone is in agreement. So already some of that text, of Dante's text, is misunderstood. It's being corrupted in a way, right? But what I love about this particular story, it reveals more about Sacchetti and the attitude of people in the 14th century about the relationship between art, literature, poetry, sound, and work, everyday work. Think of chain gangs in 19th century America, the importance of music and sound for rhythm, right? And that would be true of anyone who whistles widely at work. However, here it's curious that it almost is, you know, Sacchetti to me, I'm reading it through this bias now of sound studies, is almost as if he's creating in Dante the first sound critic or something, you know? Thank you.